Grace and peace to you, in the name of God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and in whose spirit we worship this morning. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
It is good to be in worship with you this morning. Good to be in the house of the Lord. I'm Scott Griffin. I'm the pastor here at Zion United Methodist Church. It's always good to have people in the house set to worship the Lord, an opportunity to bring our praise and glory to his name. I want to go over some announcements for you as we begin. You'll see them in your bulletin. There's also a few listed on the screen. One of the first things I want to tell you is that we have a My Gift of Presence card in your bulletin. If you wouldn't mind filling that out and giving us record of your attendance, we appreciate that. Toward the end of the service, we take an offering. And these days, we're processing forward to drop our gifts of tithes and offering, as well as these Gift of Presence card in the plates that are up front. You'll see how the rest of the congregation does that. If you're unfamiliar, you'll see that at the end of the service. At the conclusion of my sermon message, we have a closing song, and that's the time we will do that. But do please fill that out. Let us know of any prayer requests you might have, any questions or any encouragement you'd like to offer. We're happy to hear and communicate with you through the Gift of Presence card. Now, this isn't in the bulletin this week, but another thing you can do is take a look in the back. They have these Pray, Walk, Listen cards. We're engaged in the Pray, Walk, Listen here. And we're trying to walk about 200 miles as a congregation as we pray and listen to the Spirit of God, trying to lead us into what the future would be here. What's God going to do with Zion? What can God do in our midst? And we're going to pray and walk in the community. On the back side of this card, it says that we have a 6-mile radius, just as an example, of where you could walk, hopefully a place new to your feet, so you can get a glimpse of what the Spirit of God might do in our midst for those out there, maybe that don't make it by here all the time. New folks, new friends to our place. What could God lay on our hearts? Pray, walk, and listen. And then as you do, report those miles back. Now on the screen you see this little track that I created, and you can't see where the people are walking. You kind of see their feet, but you can't see all of them. But because they're up at the top, we're really close to 100 miles. Now what was happening about before the 8 o'clock service, about 7:45, we only had 48 miles, give or take. And somebody reported in that they'd walked, and I don't know if it was just one person or with a family or what, but 50 miles. So we nearly doubled it in like 5 seconds. However, one of the problems I'm struggling with is we're halfway to our goal, and once we get to our goal, we'll have a charge conference about our building committee and all that stuff. But one of the problems I'm having is I can count all the participants really on about 2 hands. There's only 150 of us, so we're less than 10% of us have started. I've got some confirmations. There'll be some walkers this week, and maybe some even people today had walked. Beautiful, beautiful things, but I want to encourage everyone that we understand the Spirit of God at work in our midst through our spiritual exercise of pray, walk, listen. And if you need to know more about it and you're here, these cards are in the back. If you're worshiping with us online, you can always check into Zion that way through the Facebook app or however you watch. Thanks for worshiping with us. And there's also these items are available on the bulletin and other resources if you're worshiping on the website. Go to our website, ziongordonville.com. You can find those things there. In your bulletin, you see some other announcements. For example, May's altar rail offering will go to Teen Challenge. We've talked about that the last few weeks. If you're having an event in the life of the church, you might want to put that on the calendar. As we're coming back from being in and out of the life of the church so much, we're forgetting to put things on the calendar from time to time. Nobody has been inconvenienced, but I want to keep that from happening. So please put some things on the life of the calendar for us so that everybody's event goes well. And then we wanted you to know Mary Gray, Mary Koenig, who is in charge of our serve committee. She's looking for 2 to 4 volunteers to help at Gordonville's play day. Not very many people, but if you're interested in that, some of us really love to participate in the Gordonville School. They're looking for someone to participate May 24th from 8:30 to 11:30. Please inform Mary Koenig about that. As we move forward in our worship this morning, we're going to begin with our scriptural call to worship. It comes from Psalm 114. Our liturgist this morning is Lillian Wendell, and she will lead us in this responsive reading. Would you stand with me and then remain standing for the opening hymn as well?
Please join me in the call to worship. When the Israelites escaped from Egypt, when the family of Jacob left that foreign land, the land of Judah became God's sanctuary, and Israel became his kingdom.
The Red Sea saw them coming and hurried out of their way. The water of the Jordan River turned away. Mountains skipped like rams, the hills like lambs.
What's wrong, Red Sea, that made you hurry out of their way? What happened, Jordan River, that you turned away?
Why mountains did you skip like rams? Why hills like lambs?
Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the God of Jacob.
He turned the rock into a pool of water.
Yes, the spring of water flowed from solid rock.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And yes, remain standing as we sing our opening song, which is led by our band, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord. All of the words will be on your screen.
Of my heart, Lord, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, 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 I want to see you.
Thank you, band. You all may be seated. At this time, the choir is going to come forward and sing to us a hymn, Be Thou My Vision. They always do a wonderful job. In the first service, we had an opportunity for Wesley Keeley to play a little piano, a little hymn, and Julie sang along. It's the offerings that we have here at Zion are pretty special, the opportunity for the people to celebrate their gifts, offer them to the Lord, and it delights all of our hearts, as our choir will do in just a moment.
Be thou my vision, O Lord.
Thanks again, choir, for your beautiful work. Our New Testament reading this morning comes from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, first chapter. It's where it begins, but then I take a few verses from that and I squeeze it together with chapter 3 so we have a little context of what's going on and what Paul wants us to understand. Again, this will be read by our liturgist this morning.
I appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, to live in harmony with each other. Let there be no divisions in the church. Rather, be of one mind, united in thought and purpose. Some of you are saying, I am a follower of Paul. Others are saying, I follow Apollos, or I follow Peter, or I follow only Christ. Has Christ been divided into factions? Was I, Paul, crucified for you? Were any of you baptized in the name of Paul? Of course not. When one of you says, I am a follower of Paul, and another says, I follow Apollos, aren't you acting just like the people of the world? After all, who is Apollos? Who is Paul? We are only God's servants through whom you believed the good news. Each of us did the work the Lord gave us. I planted the seed in your hearts, and Apollos watered it, but it was God who made it grow. It's not important who does the planting or who does the watering. What's important is that God makes the seed grow. The one who plants and the one who waters work together with the same purpose, and both will be rewarded for their own hard work. For we are both God's workers, and you are God's field. You are God's building. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
And now as we turn our hearts towards prayer, we're going to sing the hymn, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. In the Methodist hymnal, there's no verses, just the chorus, which is beautiful, but we're going to add the verses to the song this morning, so all of the words will be on the screen. If you want to have your hymnal out to sing with the notes, you can, but all of the words will be available for the three-verse song. Let's join our hearts together. bulletins and turn from the very last page, you'll see praise and prayer list and prayer requests that are listed there. As I look over this list and think about it, in the past few weeks, there's a number of prayers that have been answered in joyful ways that are even in the sanctuary today. I won't draw anybody's attention, make anybody embarrassed, but God is doing some things through Zion. Through Zion's prayers, through the prayers of this people, and through this prayer list. If you have a prayer concern, give us an opportunity. Give us an opportunity to be praying for you, put you on this list, and see what God can do. There's plenty of others who are on this list and struggling through. Let's lift all of them and all of our hearts to the Lord at this time and see what God can do. Father God, we are grateful to be your people and grateful to have a house of worship in which we can represent our praise and glory to your name for all the great things that you do. We're grateful for this springtime weather, especially this day, a day when the church doors are open. We can come and go and let the air come in and out. Fresh air, fresh spring air, helps us to remember Easter. And in this season of the church, we are Easter people for sure. We pray that as we gather in this service, the spirit of Easter just overwhelms us. The aroma of worship is what maintains today. God, some of us come with heavy hearts and difficulties in our minds. Some of us wouldn't dare put them on a prayer list. It's too close. It's too painful. It doesn't make any difference if it's on a prayer list or spoken in this moment, even quietly to you. You can minister to the point of each need. We are grateful that you are that kind of God. You are that big, that capable. We pale in comparison. We stumble over ourselves, trying to pray the right things. We're glad Scripture reminds us that the Holy Spirit is uttering to the Father on our behalf in words and in groanings that we couldn't make out even if we heard it, bringing us and all that we are to your throne of grace. And so we strive to do that as well, not just for our own concerns, but the concerns of those we love, the concerns on our prayer list. Each one have the same degree of special to you. Each one of us are valued to the same degree. We thank you for that. We pray that we are a church that represents that as well. Not only as we come and worship, but as we go back into the world and represent your kingdom out there, we represent who you are, your love for each one of us. We offer you our prayers at this time. We offer you praise and glory in our worship of you through song. We offer you the preaching of the word, all of it. May it be about your kingdom and your business. Hide our humanity, that your divinity shine through. Give us a sense of encouragement today where we are weak, where we are struggling, where we don't know what to do. Bring us your wisdom. Help us in this time in the life of America and the struggle of coronavirus that's nearly over, it would seem. Help us to hold fast to our best choices and hold fast to you. You have seen us through. We give you praise and glory. We know that you use humanity, you use doctors and different things, but all things good come from you. So we give your name praise for that. Carry us through and carry us on. And we'll continue to give you praise the way we do each and every week by saying together the prayer you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And our Old Testament reading, which is the sermon text for this morning, comes from Exodus 14, verses 10 through 18. And again, it'll be read by our liturgist for this morning, Lillian Wendell.
As Pharaoh approached, the people of Israel looked up and panicked when they saw the Egyptians overtaking them. They cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, "Why did you bring us out here to die in the wilderness? Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? What have you done to us? Why did you make us leave Egypt? Didn't we tell you this would happen while we were still in Egypt? We said, 'Leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians, It's better to be a slave in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness. But Moses told the people, don't be afraid. Just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm. Then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving. Pick up your staff and raise your hand over the sea. Divide the water so the Israelites can walk through the middle of the sea on dry ground. And I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they will charge in after the Israelites. My great glory will be displayed through Pharaoh and his troops, his chariots and his charioteers. When my glory is displayed through them, all Egypt will see my glory and know that I am the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
And now we have a moment for children's time. And if the children would join me down front, I have a little bit of a science experiment, maybe even a little magic show. Come on down front. Hi guys, in just a moment I'm going to need some help from you, okay? So you might need to be around here. So you can come down here anytime you're ready, because I'm going to need your help. So for those of you who can't see what we're doing, I have pre-recorded some videos so that you can see what's happening on the screen at the appropriate time, okay? So we'll get there in a moment. Now the scripture lesson that we're talking about for the sermon today is the story of Exodus, where Exodus kind of means exit, where the Israelites exit Egypt, and they're headed to the promised land, but they get stuck up against the Red Sea. And so they kind of get pinned in, and then Pharaoh's armies is coming after them. But this is all after 400 years of praying and praying that God would do something to free them from being slaves in Egypt. So finally their prayers are answered, and they're answered through 10 plagues. 10 plagues happen, and finally Pharaoh says, okay, you can go. But then he thinks better of it. So I'm going to pour some water into this plate here. Fill it up a little bit. And then the army starts following him, coming to fight the Israelites, and the Israelites are getting worried. They're pinned in, and that's where we see them in our scripture this morning. So what I want you to do is take this pepper, and I want you to sprinkle it onto the water in the plate. Everybody take a turn, okay? Go ahead, sprinkle some pepper on the plate. So we've got a video that shows that, if we haven't already shown it. Oh, sprinkle a lot. Just go ahead. This kind of represents all of the Egyptian soldiers coming after the Israelites. Yeah, keep jumping. Yeah, keep going. You want to do it? Oh, she's got it. She's trying to figure it out. There you go. Here you go. Do some more. You only got a few shakes. Do some more. Yeah. Okay, I'll do some too. I think this thick pepper is getting stuck in here. There we go. Get this all peppery. That's what we need. Pepper, water. It's good stuff. Okay. Thank you very much, helpers. Now I need you to do something else. When the God's people saw the Egyptian army and chariots coming, they got a little worried, and they couldn't do anything about it. Let's see if you can do something. See if you touch the water. See what happens. Does anything happen if you touch the water? No? You can wipe off on this napkin. Now your finger's all peppery. Anybody else? You touch. Anybody else can touch it. Go ahead. You get to wipe your finger off. There's a reach. Oh, nothing much happened there. What about you? You want to touch it? There you go. He touched the, I thought he was going to like splash, but it was just, he just kind of got top of it. Okay, do you want to touch it? Nothing happened. The people couldn't do anything. You'll probably need to wipe all that pepper off. People couldn't do anything about it. But Moses said, don't be afraid, even though they didn't know what to do. Don't be afraid. Just stand still and watch God save you today. The Egyptians you see today, this pepper in this plate, will never be the same again. Moses said, you'll never see me. You're going to see this pepper. Something's going to happen, though, in just a second. So Moses took his staff and spread his arms out over the waters, and the waters began to part just like this. Watch this. When I touch it. Did you see that? See how all the pepper spread out? I can split pepper, but Moses can part the Red Sea. Yeah, that deserves as much. That's the best I can do, so might as well clap for that. And what this tells us, this is just a silly representation of what was really meaningful and really helpful for the Israelites to be able to make it into the promised land. God did these amazing things. He promised to be there for them, and he was. Even in this awkward, hard moment, they couldn't get through here, and they were getting penned in by the army, but God had a plan. He has a plan for each one of you in the same way, and he will overcome your circumstances and the Red Seas that you come up against in life, too. He'll do the same for you, and that's the good news for today. Would you repeat after me? Dear Jesus, we thank you for your love. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for your power. Holy Spirit, lead us into all goodness throughout all of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys so much. You can now head back to your seats. One wrong move and we'll have pepper all over the place. I don't know how familiar you are with this story. I'm kind of familiar with the complaining of the Israelites in the story that we read from Exodus. Have you ever thought about how taxing their complaining would have been to Moses? How tedious their complaints would have seemed? Now, this scripture may be one of the first times where we see the Israelites complain about all the things that they complain about, but there are numerous others where their complaints show that they quit on Moses, they quit on themselves, and most importantly, they quit on God. And we know that they quit even before they utter their complaints because their complaints prove that they've already quit. Their minds are already made up about the tragedy of their circumstance. There's no way around it, it's just a tragedy. But then they voice their complaints in the form of a question. And a question expects a response. Now, I don't think they're actually all questions. Some of these are more accusations. They're accusation-laden. Response-expecting questions are abundant. I mean, they just keep asking them. Verses 11 and 12 show us what they look like. Why did you bring us out here to die in the wilderness? That wasn't the reason we left. You prayed for 400 years so you could be released. Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? That's not even a question. That's an accusation with a question mark at the end. Didn't we tell you this would happen while we're still in Egypt? We said, leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians. You prayed for 400 years to be released. It's better to be a slave in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness. Well, if those are our two options, you might be right. I think God's got some other plans. This would be so draining to me if I was Moses. Just so draining, just sucking the life out of me. Years ago, April and I took a course on parenting called Love and Logic. One of its primary tenets is, let the consequences do the teaching. Some parents, especially us newer ones, or us at the time anyway, we tend to want to soothe away any and every pain that we can, even that pain which has a natural consequence due to their actions. For example, let's say that you've got a young one, an older aged toddler, but a young one who's been struggling with hitting. Sometimes that's rather embarrassing, especially for young moms when they're carting them out to different places and their kid's a hitter. I don't know. How did they learn this? How did he or she pick this up? We don't do this at home. Well, the biblical answer to that, by the way, is it's all part of our inborn sin nature expressing itself, but that's just me as a pastor digressing. I'll move on. In the midst of this struggle, you and your little angel hitter, they hit another kid who's not having any of it, doesn't like this, and wallops your precious so hard they fall over. Smack, flop. Love and Logic says to always comfort, but don't minimize the natural consequences away with your words. Always comfort. Some parents choose to instead make it about the other kid who did wrong, and then they alert their parents, blaming the other child for the whole problem, knowing full well they have a hitter in their own family. As a result, your child cannot connect the dots between action and consequence as easy. You steal the lesson of the natural consequence from your child if you lay all the blame on the other kid when you know full well that little Janie, little Johnny has a hitting habit. Let the consequences do the teaching, says the program. Ask your little hitter, what happened? And when they say, so-and-so hit me, be sure and say something like, oh, I'm so sorry. Bring them close, draw them in, hug them. Being hit doesn't feel good, does it? You don't say this as to to rub their nose in it. That's not the parent's job to overdo it and rub the little one's noses in the consequence. That's why I tell you not to hit anybody. That's not where we're supposed to go. But it might be helpful at times to ask something that might lead the child to the teaching available that's in the consequence. For example, well, why did they hit you?
I don't know.
May or may not be the case. Could it be because you hit them first? And really asking the question the right way is really where everything's at. You don't even have, they don't have to tell the truth in their answer. Could it be because you hit them first? You're just helping them connect the dots. Again, if they happen to say yes, always comfort them. Always hug them and say you're sorry that they're hurt and that they're sad. Inwardly, you're acknowledging sometimes there are certain consequences that the best remedy for is a child to learn the natural consequence. That way they don't learn to do it again. One of the more logical statements of love and logic, that makes sense, was that the consequences early in life are not nearly as dire as they are later. If you disobey your parents and suffer the consequences, it goes a little easier than when you disobey the law and suffer those consequences. For older kids, not just toddlers, it gave some parenting advice. It said a line that they gave their parents was, "Your complaining drains the energy out of me." It's a true statement for me. Your complaining drains the energy out of me. I don't think I have the energy to take you to your game or to go shopping as we had planned. That's one of the lines they said. That may sound a little passive aggressive to some of us, like you're sort of threatening, but it's actually true. I read this just this week about a workplace environment. It said, those who frequently complain can be experienced as energy vampires by others. Truly, sucking the life right out of you. That's my experience. Those who frequently complain can be experienced as energy vampires by others. That's how I experience them. So I'm going to go ahead and say amen to that, even if no one else does. Incessant complaining wears me out. And it's not just complaining, it's negativity. Don't get me wrong. I've gone through depression a couple times in my life, and I've been the negative nabob in people's little world. I needed someone to listen. Everybody needs someone to listen, but just whenever we're in a group of people and they just move from negative comment to negative comment, and that wearing me out. I can't take it. So now let's apply what we know about our world today and apply that to Moses and the Israelites and their complaining and how they complained, sentence after sentence, accusation after accusation with a question mark on the end, demanding some type of response. I mean, that's crazy stuff. No wonder. No wonder he made a few mistakes along the way. Probably made a lot more. For those of you who may not remember the story, he helps them escape Egypt. They do get through this moment across the Red Sea. But they continue to complain. They even pit his brother against him at one point in time. They make it all the way across the wilderness, God doing all of these amazing things, and they get to the edge of the promised land, and God can do all this stuff, but somehow he can't beat people who are bigger than us. They're giants. There's just, we can't handle it. There's nothing we can do about it. So they choose not to go in the promised land, and God wanders them around in the desert for another 40 years where a whole generation of people aren't there to complain anymore. And then they finally go back in. But they complain sort of along the way. They just complain and complain. We're thirsty. So at one point in time, they complain that. And Moses is told to smack the rock and the water comes out. Another time, they come to the rock. And Moses is told to speak to the rock. But he kind of loses it. I don't blame him. I don't know that I would have done as well. And he smacks the rock again instead of speaking to it. And the natural consequence for him, he didn't get to make it into the promised land because he disobeyed God. But I think about the environment he was in. All of those energy vampires just sucking the life out of him. I think I would have probably done at least as bad as Moses did, if not much worse. No wonder he made a few mistakes. The people may have left Egypt, but their questions prove that their minds maintain a certain kind of slavery mentality. Somehow, some way, maybe it's because it's all they knew, there's an actual comfort in being enslaved. They said it themselves. They couldn't wait to go back. Verse 12 ended by saying, "Leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians." If Moses didn't act quickly, they were already starting to round each other up, go back the other directions. Let's see if we can meet his army halfway. They were ready to go back. That doesn't make any sense that they would choose to do that. But Moses was different. As we continue to read in the scripture, verses 13 and 14 says that Moses told the people, "Don't be afraid. Just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm." How encouraging is it to think about the Lord himself will fight for you? That's calming in and of itself. And it's obvious, however, from the next two verses. I don't know if you caught this, but it's obvious that Moses didn't know. At that very moment that the people noticed Pharaoh approaching, he didn't know what was about to happen. He didn't know what God was going to do. He wasn't thinking about this, well, I have some inside knowledge. God and he hadn't spoken about the specifics beforehand. We know this because of exactly what the next two verses say. 15 and 16, the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving." Moses went from his conversation where he said, "Just stay calm," to crying out to God on behalf of the people. "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving. Pick up your staff and raise your hand over the sea. Divide the water so the Israelites can walk through the middle of the sea on dry ground." If Moses had known precisely what he was supposed to do, he wouldn't have been crying out to God on behalf of the people. He would have said, "Just stay calm," and turned around and done it. Yet in response to the people freaking out about Pharaoh's pursuit, he still said, "Don't be afraid. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm." So what do you think explains Moses' attitude versus the people's attitude about Pharaoh's army pinning the Israelites up against the Red Sea? That's a tough spot to be in. What do you think explains Moses' attitude of supreme confidence in God, not knowing his plan in that moment at all, versus the people's attitude? Well, you might say, if you were cheating and looking at the front of your bulletin, you might say eyes of faith. And I would agree. Eyes of faith. But why would Moses have eyes of faith and no one else? Why was Moses the only one? And it's not because he's the Lord's anointed. I think it's the choice to have eyes of faith. The truth of their immediate circumstances was dire. There's no way around that. They were hemmed in and likely to be destroyed or re-enslaved more harshly. And could you imagine how mad Pharaoh would be if he had to catch up with you? After 10 plagues and all this stuff, got to catch up with you and you get re-enslaved, it's not going to go well. But that's not the picture of all of their circumstances. Where they're at in that moment is not the whole story. Think about it. Had anything ever happened like what had just occurred in order to set them free from their slavery? The death of all the firstborn and only the firstborn in Egypt. Had anything like that ever happened? Never. Not only that, but then there was the previous 9 plagues in a row, too. And all of it designed for the Israelites to be precisely in this situation, up against the Red Sea, with Pharaoh in hot pursuit. They had followed the plan and the leadership of the Lord. That's what led them to this moment. And the plan of God, the whole time, as he had made known early in the process, was to have them live freely and no longer enslaved. That was the plan, and we see it in Exodus 6:6. God talking to Moses, and he says immediately, "Therefore say to the people of Israel." So the whole beginning of this was to be known. Here's what God has to say to us. "I am the Lord. I will free you from your oppression and will rescue you from your slavery in Egypt. I will redeem you with a powerful arm and great acts of judgment." And then they've seen all of that take place. This was 8 chapters ago and 10 plagues, which had never happened before like this, ago. Death up against the Red Sea. That was not in God's disclosed plan. And that means that God's plan wasn't finished. God's plan wasn't finished. If the Israelites had chosen to look with eyes of faith and take time to remember the full story of what brought them to this moment, they probably would have a similar response to Moses. And that's not just true for the Israelites, the people of God, in their day. It's still a true notion for the people of God today. When we take the time, amidst the troubling circumstance of the moment, to trace our steps back to the way it began, and we can see that we followed the leadership of the Spirit to this moment of fret, we can easily realize God's plans for us aren't complete. God didn't send us on this journey for it to fail here. So instead of living in fret, that's reasonable. I mean, it's reasonable to be concerned where they were. We can choose to live instead with eyes of faith, focusing on the path which God has led us to follow. God set us on that path, and that's the beauty of our purpose in pray, walk, listen. The purpose is to prepare our eyes of faith as a body of Christ for what the Lord's future is for us, so that we readily accept it, like Moses, instead of like the rest of the people of Israel, floundering and pining, even for the days of the past enslavement, which happens a lot in those moments of high stress. If we seek with eyes of faith the will of God, our God is faithful. He's faithful, and he will reveal his will to us. Then as we walk along the path, tracing God's leadership from the beginning to whatever moment in which we find ourselves, we can more readily overcome fear and reduce the infighting that can result, which is what we saw with Israelites and Moses. And throughout their journey, they're always quitting on themselves, quitting on Moses, and doing some infighting and bringing Aaron into the mix along the path. Now, friends, I do believe that in the future plans for this church, there will be an opportunity for infighting. And while I'm not excited about that, I believe that whenever we are pursuing, whenever a church is pursuing with excellence what God would have us do, the attacks of the enemy increase. One of the best ways for the church to scuttle its purpose is to fight with itself. And I don't want to see that happen to us. I, like Paul in the opening of his letter to the Corinthians, appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, to live in harmony with each other. Let there be no divisions in the church. Rather, be of one mind, united in thought. And for me today, I'm going to focus on the last word, united in purpose. That's precisely what our physical, spiritual exercise is designed to accomplish. We will not always agree about how to achieve God's purposes in the best way, but we can easily find agreement in what that purpose is and then discern together some reasonable ways to accomplish it. Now, it may not be your favorite way, may not be my favorite way, but given the Lord's leading, I believe it's going to be inarguable that the direction we end up going, the direction we make, decision we make is reasonable within God's purposes for us. We can be united in purpose. And it is in those moments that we choose to see with eyes of faith, even the plans that we're just not as excited about. We choose to see those plans with eyes of faith as able to accomplish God's purposes through us. It still has God's purpose in mind. Maybe a different plan than what I would choose, but it's God's purpose. It's gonna achieve God's purposes. Why? Why in the world would we go against our own gut feelings? I don't know about you, but God gave me this gut, and it works. My gut feelings are good in God's kingdom a lot of time. God uses my gut feelings to get kingdom work done. It's a good thing. I don't know why it would be any different from you. Why would I bail on the way that God works with me and go along with somebody else's opinion? I don't agree with it anyway. I can only think of one reason. Only because you and me, like Moses, are able to trace the understanding of God's purpose from the beginning of us pursuing that purpose through to that moment of fret or that moment of disagreement and realize that God's plan is not finished. It's well worth pursuing and chasing after and seeing with eyes of faith that the course of action you disagree with is still absolutely on board and tracking with God's original purpose. It may not be exactly how you do it, how I do it, but you can't deny the leadership of the Holy Spirit. In that kind of circumstance, friends, choose eyes of faith. But let's spin it around a little bit. Let's turn it 180 degrees. What if Moses was all wrong in that moment? What if things had gone off the rails? How would the Israelites, how in the world would they have known that Moses was wrong? And then you apply that to our church. What if church folk here aren't tracking with the Spirit of God? How would we know that? How would we know that they're not tracking with the Spirit? Well, I can guarantee you at least one way to get closer to knowing if that's the case in Zion's future. I can guarantee you one way. You may have heard of it. It's called pray, walk, listen. Paul said it himself in our reading from 1 Corinthians. You are God's field. You are God's building. God desires to build us up. And how's he going to do that? Well, we've got to hear that from the Lord himself. We've got to seek the face of the Lord and hear what he has to say, which means we've got to engage in some kind of spiritual exercise, which would allow us the mind of Christ in a time such as this. So I continue to encourage you, pray, walk, and listen. It's not really about the walking. It's about the praying and the listening. It's about the seeking the face of God while we're out and about, not in our usual places. What is God going to use us to do to make a difference in the lives of the people who aren't yet here? There are people in our community who desperately need Jesus, and God has a plan to use Zion, just like every other church, to reach them. But you and I, we're not committed to every other church. We have a charge to keep here. When Zion comes up against our Red Sea moment, because the devil will try to thwart God's plans through us, I want us enabled by pray, walk, listen to see with eyes of faith that we might limit our potential complaints and minimize those squabbles and infighting. Those things will drain our energy, just suck the life right out of us from accomplishing God's plan for us. It's too important. Eyes of faith empower us, though. Eyes of faith empower us to persevere harmoniously through fretful moments, united by the leadership of the Spirit of God. We're led by God, His Spirit. After seeking His face, we can have much, much more understanding about what God has planned for us if we've gone out of our way to try to find God's will and discern that. And then when there are disagreements, they're minor, they're different. You know, we've got one of five options that'll work. I'm planning on option number two. But we choose one, going against what I want. But it's still one of the options that will work to accomplish God's purpose. Let us be a church united in God's purpose. And as we come out of this time where we weren't even able to do this very often, be here in worship. So we come out of this time, have a new beginning. And we can track the Lord's Spirit from this beginning to wherever He's going to take us. And we come up to those moments of indecision, those moments of squabble, those moments of complaints. We have an opportunity, a way through that already. We don't have to get stuck there. Eyes of faith toward the purpose of God for Zion's church. That's where we want to be. And I can't wait to see what God's going to do with us. Whenever we get to that moment, and we choose to see with eyes of faith, we have a grand future in front of us. I'm so excited to do it with you. In response to the word of the Lord today, we're going to sing the hymn, Here I Am, Lord. The verses talk about all the things that God sees and all the things that God does. I am this kind of God. This is where my heart is. This is what I want to do for you. Whom shall I send? We have an opportunity. Here I am, Lord. Is it I? I've heard you calling in the night. God's going to call us. God's going to use us. Pray, walk, listen, eyes of faith. It's just going to get better and better, friends. Let's stand together as we respond in song. Hear now this benediction from Romans chapter 15. May God, who gives patience and encouragement, help you live in complete harmony with each other, as is fitting for followers of Christ Jesus. Then all of you can join together with one voice, giving praise and glory to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You are dismissed. Have a great weekend, everyone.